gives the public something to look at. You know what I mean? Although it's a big thing and it looks awkward and all that, but there's something about it. It's a work of a craftsman, I would say. Really speaking, it's a work of a craftsman.
So what we've done is we've got sort of an event in three parts in some ways. We've got a book, and a book that's about a sculpture, and then we have the publisher of that book, and we have the sculptor, we have, and then we have a moderator that is going to be facilitating a discussion between the publisher and the sculptor. So to say a little bit about who these people are behind their titles, Garth Evans is the sculptor here sitting in the middle. Then we've got Julia Klein, the publisher, to his left, and then to their right is Jacque. They're all going to say a little bit more about what they do, so I'm not going to give elaborate biographies, and most of you have this program here. If you don't have it, let me know. Jacque is going to facilitate our conversation after Julia and Garth introduce the project. And so I'll say a little bit about Jacque just so you have some context for who is asking these questions at the end of our discussion. Jacque's an artist. He's been an organizer of a number of different artist-run spaces like Grizzly Grizzly and Vox Populi here in Philadelphia. He got his degree, his MFA degree from Cranbrook in Detroit. And finally, one of the reasons that that we asked Jacque to join us is, in addition to being a practicing artist, he also, for the last 2 years, has served as the director of the Percent for Art program that supports public art here at the city of Philadelphia. And so after Julia and Garth share a little bit about the project and then the sculpture that instigated this book, then Jacque will lead a discussion with them. We'll wrap up around 8 o'clock. Does anyone have any questions about that? Does anyone have any announcements they'd like to make to this captive audience of people? Surely you've got some interesting things going on that are topically relevant. All right, well, without further ado, then I'm going to hand it off to Julia Klein, who's going to talk a little bit about this wonderful book.
Thanks, Daniel. It's nice to be here. So a little bit about the background of the book. In 2014, I was introduced to Garth Evans by John Wood, who is a research curator at the Henry Moore Institute in Leeds in England. I'm a big fan of the Institute and its unwavering and rigorous focus on sculpture from all angles, and I was curiously pleased that there is a project that John felt might be right for Soberscove, which is the name of the press that I run. Happily, it turned out that I immediately felt an overwhelming enthusiasm about the proposal. The project revolved around the documentation of responses to a public sculpture that Garth had installed in Cardiff, Wales in 1972. The morning after the sculpture was installed, Garth asked passersby about the work and recorded responses from people who didn't normally talk about art. He purposely didn't present himself as the artist or talk about the piece itself. He just asked people what they thought about it. In the transcript, I like how the people he talked to described their visual impressions of the sculpture, sometimes without even actually trying to describe it. They just kind of refer to those shapes that are leaning up against each other, or, you know, whatever. And in so doing, they expressed feelings ranging from pleasure to curiosity to confusion and even anger. And ultimately, this is a picture of the sculpture being installed. Ultimately, the piece was graffitied, as many of the pieces that were part of the larger sculpture project with Garth, which Garth will talk about, were. I like how you learn through some of the responses of the people that were asked what they thought about art in general. What's it for, people kept wanting to know. I believe I read the transcript before I saw images of the sculpture, and I liked learning about the piece that way. It's unusual to know an artwork through language rather than image. In addition to the audio, photographic, and written descriptions of the work, further layers of documentation also existed. The audio recording functioned as an element in a piece that Garth did later that same year, and the sculpture continues to exist on the grounds of Charnwood College in the UK. And in fact, Garth is in the process of trying to temporarily repatriate the sculpture to Cardiff and to have to do a second recording of people's responses to the sculpture. The transcript is also the basis for a theatrical performance that will take place later this winter. And of course, here's the piece with minor graffiti. There's pieces that have a lot more graffiti on them. Of course, the transcript is reproduced in the book, The Cardiff Tapes, a form that not only tells the story of the sculpture's reception, but also explores its context as part of a larger public sculpture project in the UK, its context in Garth's life and career, as well as his views on sculpture and being an artist. One of the things that I really like about the book is that there are a lot of paths that the project can take you down. And I'll read a short passage from the introduction that speaks to this and that will lead into Garth talking about the project and then into our conversation. So this is from Garth's introduction. In the late 1960s, I was examining my role as an artist. I was concerned that my success served only to reinforce the political, social, and economic status quos. My studio practice was in crisis. I wanted to make something that, although I could still classify it as a sculpture, did not offer itself to the viewer as an object, and thus could not be so easily commodified. The opportunity to make two large public sculptures was irresistible. There was another public sculpture that he was working on at the time. Would it be possible to connect with a non-art world audience, people whom I felt I could, by means of my working class family background, identify with? And with that, I will let Garth take the podium.
If I start to mumble, let me know, will you? Thank you, Julia, for that very nice introduction. Thank you, Daniel. It's wonderful to be here. Thank you for the invitation. I had graduated from the Slade in 1960, and about 1967, 68, I was making sculptures like this, out of fiberglass, quite large. And in 1969, I became involved with a group called the Artist Placement Group, which sought to place artists in organizations, companies, industrial organizations, government bodies, whatever, without the artist having any particular obligations to the organization, but to simply act as a kind of maverick within the organization and produce work or not, using the resources of the organization, whatever they might be. And I was the first person to become affiliated with an organization. I received what was called a fellowship with the British Steel Corporation. My obligation to the corporation was to work in steel for the period of the fellowship. I wasn't obligated to make any sculpture. I made numerous proposals to the organization about things I wanted to do. And I visited a lot of places where steel was made and handled. And I took a lot of photographs. As Julia has indicated, part of my involvement with APG and part of my willingness to take on this role of fellow with the British Steel Corporation was a sense that I wanted to re-examine my artistic practice. And indeed, to consider whether I could continue to have a studio-based practice. simultaneously with this, I was involved in a very radical teaching program at St. Martin's School of Art, in which I and a few colleagues were seeking to reconsider our role as teachers of art. These photographs, I realize much later, really constitute a kind of sketchbook that I'm compiling of things that interested me, and which interested me as possible sculpture, you know, things that could conceivably be sculpture or could lead to sculpture. These photographs, I more recently made a selection of 164 prints, which were acquired by the Henry Moore Institute and shown there fairly recently. During the course of my fellowship, the opportunity to make a proposal for a very large steel sculpture, or a very large sculpture, I would make it in steel, in the town of Ebbw Vale in South Wales came up, and I made a successful proposal for that. This Peter Stuyvesant City Sculpture Project came along, which invited me to make a proposal for a large sculpture to go in a city center somewhere, and I chose Cardiff as the city I wanted to work in, and I chose a particular location in the city to place my sculpture in. The location I chose was a very ordinary, unpretentious, large section of sidewalk in a very mixed neighborhood. I wasn't at all sure what I wanted to do, but I knew I wanted to do something that would both be seemed to have some kind of connection to the industrial history of the area, which my family had some connections to, coal mining and steel making. So something that had the potential to seem like it might have a use. But I also wanted something very simple and stark. And in some ways, I came to think of it by the time the thing was made as it having the possibility of being a memorial of some kind to the men and boys who died in the mines, the coal mines in South Wales, and to one particular disaster. But all of this was just in my head. It wasn't anything I disclosed to anybody. One of the things I did with in relation to the artist placement group during this time and in the course of my trying to figure out how to proceed as an artist was participate in a very large exhibition at the Hayward Gallery in London, which APG put on, and this is my contribution to that exhibition. And this is an image of the work that I proposed for the Ebbw Vale Commission. Which went got a long way, but never finally was realized and became a victim of local politics. And this is my proposal for the Cardiff sculpture. We have some more images of it at the little drawing that came to light recently. I gave it to one of the organizers of the Peter Stuyvesant City Sculpture Project. He drew my attention to the fact that I'd given it to him. I'd completely forgotten, because there is currently an organization, an exhibition being organized at the Henry Moore Institute about the Peter Stuyvesant City Sculpture Project, and that will open in November, and so that little drawing will be part of that exhibition. This is my sculpture arriving. You can see the kind of general location. There's a new office block there. There's a pub and a chapel on the other side of the street. And there's some archways, to some more upscale shopping back over there. But this is a pretty kind of raw location. And that's me placing the sculpture and smoking with my long hair, me making sure it's in the right place. And I had gone there with a professional looking microphone and a tape recorder with the intention of going out the next day and asking people what they thought of it. And without saying what they thought of this sculpture or my sculpture or just, what do you think? What do you think of this? And that recording fascinated me. I did use it in another sculpture in which I put it in an upside down garbage can with these voices coming out of the garbage can. One of the things that struck me about the recording was that the people responding to the sculpture could have been responding to anything. You had no idea listening. I think you have no idea listening to the recording, what it is they're responding to. It could have been a garbage can. They were not very respectful. Some students at the St. Martin School of Art in London have been engaged with this project, this Cardiff project, and unearthed some people in Cardiff who actually remember the sculpture, which was fascinating. They don't remember it fondly, but they do remember it. It says something, I suppose. So here we are after the arrangement. The project arranged for the sculptures to be in the cities. There were 16 sculptures placed in 8 cities across Great Britain. So there were 2 in Cardiff, mine and another one. And the sculptures would be kept in the cities for 6 months, at the end of which the various cities had the option of buying them from the artists for very modest amounts of money, because everything had been paid for, the fabrication and the siting and everything. None of the cities did actually retain the sculptures, and some of them were badly treated, and one or two actually destroyed. I did go back at some point during the 6 months and take some more photographs, so you see some of them. I mean, I had anticipated that the sculpture would get climbed on and would get, graffiti and posters stuck on it, and I had wanted, I had kind of thought I want a form that is simple enough and clear enough that is not going to destroy it. It would have been better if it got completely covered, I think, completely camouflaged, but it wasn't there long enough, it seems. This is where it is now, outside a college in Leicestershire in England, and not being taken care of and not valued at all, as far as I can tell. And as Julia said, during the preparation of the book, I began to think, I didn't know where it was, but I began to think if I could find it and borrow it and take it back to Cardiff and make another recording, it would be really interesting to see what the response was, to the same object close to 50 years later. So we're planning to do that. This is the object, which is not an object, a sculpture, that eventually came out of my crisis in the studio, and it was the thing that led me to be able to go back in and keep making sculpture, not recordings. A very large steel sculpture which occupied the entire studio, and this is it shown at a major exhibition at the Royal Academy in 1972, when the Royal Academy in London dragged itself into the 20th century and showed a major exhibition of contemporary British sculpture. And this is a recent photograph of it installed at St. Martin's School of Art. So that's what I have to say, I think. I think there's lots more to talk about. And I expect that Jacque will be causing trouble now.
And did you all, do you want to listen to some of the audio now or at a later juncture? Just because I need to switch it over. Yeah. Yeah, we'll just play a little bit, not the whole full thing.
I'm absolutely flabbergasted. I don't know what it is. What is it? It's what I think it is. It looks like a vast piece of metal. Geometrical design. It's meant to mystify us, is it?
I just wanted to see that all, what it was. I don't know. Yeah, it's not here. It looks like a fly to me. What is it? Anyway. I don't know. It looks like a lamppost. Stand up the wrong way. I don't know what it is.
I assumed it was some peculiar monument to somebody. We don't know.
Well, quite frankly, I don't understand it. If it's a new venture, something to... It's a talking point, I suppose, but... I came down specially to look at it. I saw it on TV last night. Came down specially to look at it. I'd like to know what it's all about. Is it made of steel? It must have been difficult to work with the size of it. It's different, I don't know.
I haven't got a clue. I don't know what it's sponsored or anything. I haven't got the faintest idea. Well, I'd like to know, like, what it's really for, like, you know what I mean? But I haven't got the faintest idea, you know, like. Well, I don't know. I can't explain it, can I?
If I don't know what it's for.
And that was an edited, a bunch of different clips put together.
And that was over the course of one morning, right?
Yeah.
So can everybody hear us? Our mics are all working and such?
Okay.
All right. Well, first I want to say thank you, Daniel, getting us together. I think there's a lot of really interesting points where this can go to. As Daniel said, I'm a artist, but also an artist administrator. I think you talked a little bit about the beginning, about how this came about, but just so that everybody's clear on the context, to make public art happen in general, it takes a huge confluence of events to happen. And so there's the artist placement program, and you correct me here if I'm for sure will say it incorrectly, but so there's the artist placement program that happened at this time when you are making work and very known, right? And then so this was a revolutionary program in Britain then that was placing artists in a place where they're not really supposed to go to.
Right? Yeah, it was an artist organization. It mm-hmm. had funding from the Arts Council, which at some point was withdrawn inevitably because we were being accused of social engineering instead of being artists. But it had no official status other than that it did receive some funding from the Arts Council of Great Britain.
But then it also got money from a private organization?
No, except when an artist was given the placement, when an organization accepted the premise and selected or gave an artist, then it was up to the artist to negotiate the terms, really.
And the organization that you were working with was?
British Steel Corporation. British Steel Corporation had taken over a fellowship scheme from the old Iron and Steel Federation when it was when the industry was nationalized after the Second World War. And that fellowship scheme really was designed to fund research in universities and polytechnics that I guess the industry thought it might be able to profit from. And they had been persuaded to offer one of these fellowships to an artist. And they undertook to select the artist. They went through a selection process. And I was selected. So I mean, I applied for this very casually, without any real kind of sense of what I was getting myself into. But once I got into it, I really did get involved and feel very engaged.
And at that time, you were making studio work, basically living the artist dream, selling a lot of work, right? You were commercially successful.
It was the right? 60s. You know.
What does that mean?
It was a time of optimism and people were buying it. Yeah.
And then making the artwork, this public art opportunity came along, and then you were interested in expanding your artistic practice in a way, right?
Yeah. Well, I don't know about expanding it. I mean, I don't think it was a question of expanding it. I mean, I think it was a question of rethinking it. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I really. As Julia, I think, said in quoting me, I mean, I think I had begun to feel uneasy, best way of putting it, about what the ultimate consequences of my activity were, the big picture. And uneasy is the best way of saying it. I think I had no clear sense except that the people who bought my work were rich people who didn't need it and didn't know what to do with it. And and it seemed to be that I was simply reinforcing the status quo as the way that practice is.
So then making public art was a way of returning it to a different realm?
I thought, let's see, this is an opportunity, let's grab it and see what comes of it. And maybe, that's something one could engage in. Yeah.
I think it's very, interesting that the way the artwork meets the public, and you kind of were alluding to that a little bit when If the artwork in a commercial sense, right, is only reaching a certain audience, right, but then all of a sudden when it's in a public realm, then it reaches a different audience.
Yes. Yes. Can there be a real connection there? Can one actually make? I mean, clearly, if you make something and it's exhibited and somebody writes a check and takes it home, you've made a real connection. Regardless of what you think about that. I mean, that's
a commitment.
That's a very real exchange. And I don't know of anything comparable, really. But was it a question then?
I don't know.
No. Did you think there was a question?
I was still thinking about the commitment to people buying a lot of things in the 60s. But I'm curious about, so you after you got done with the piece, which, what was the title of the piece in Cardiff?
It didn't have a title. I mean, I didn't want to give it a title. Titles are very tricky things, And I didn't give it a title then, and now I just refer to it as Cardiff, Cardiff piece, or just Cardiff.
The piece that you showed after that, the floor piece.
Breakdown.
Breakdown. That signaled a return back to the studio.
Yeah, that seemed, followed on from that was a whole series of carpet-like works that were very, you know, took up a lot of space on the ground but didn't come up very high, and which seemed to solve my problem of I had this idea of wanting to make a sculpture, something I could call a sculpture that didn't offer itself as an object, as a thing, you know. And I ended up making these things out of transparent material that were just like a shimmer on the ground, you know. And at that point, I began to get nervous that they were disappearing, and I began to feel the need to return to something that had some real physical presence.
Is that stainless steel?
No. The thing that was that breakdown, that big steel piece, was just regular steel. It was painted silver.
Interesting. So it was kind of like you wanted to disappear a little bit, you know?
Well, what followed from that did begin to disappear, yeah. But I didn't want to disappear.
Going back to the process of how you conceived of the Cardiff piece. And so you were a fellow in this company for 2 years, mm-hmm. Is that right? And then so the goal of your fellowship was not to make an object, actually, right? Can you talk a little bit about what that process was? And
well, my obligation, as I said, my obligation to the corporation was to try to work in steel in my studio and to keep some written account of that. And so I gave them quarterly reports, which they liked, apparently.
Corporate style.
I couldn't make a sculpture in my studio. I did get a lot of equipment and a lot of steel, and I would go there every day and sleep. And then I'd play with the steel, and then I'd sleep some more, and so on. But at the same time, I was being very inquisitive and nosy, and going to all kinds of places that the industry would allow me to go to and send me to, and I was making proposals to the corporation to try to situate myself outside the studio in an industrial setting and do goodness knows what, you know. And they never ultimately accepted any of these proposals.
Zero.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and I mean, it finally came down to me, to them, one of the people who'd facilitated the fellowship, proposing that I go to a steelworks that had just been closed. And this was up in the northeast in Scunthorpe, I think, in the northeast of England. And I went up there, and it was wonderful. They welcomed me. They showed me everything. It was this small rolling plant that had just been closed, and you know, everything was there. And they asked me what I needed, and I said, "Well, you know, I don't really know, some welding equipment, and maybe you know some help handling." Is it, can you use some help? I said, yeah, I can use some help. And he said, we've got apprentices. You could you use them?
These are the workers, the people who are doing
It turned out that the steelworks, the industry had an apprenticeship, and it was a 5-year apprenticeship. Uh-huh. And before you completed your 5 years, you couldn't actually fully do the job or get fully paid. But what they told me was, you know, these guys, these young guys who are apprentices, they've learned everything they need to know somewhere in their third year. You know, we don't know what to do with them. And if you could give them something to do and use them, you know, how many could you use?
Okay. Yeah.
20 could you? I was going to go up there, I was going to have a blast. I didn't know what I was going to do, but, you know, I would have. It didn't happen.
Why did it not happen?
Well, because finally I found out it's not happening because they worried about publicity, bad publicity. They just put, I don't know, 180 men out of work closing this plant, and now there's this artist going in there and playing. Like, it could be construed that these men have been put out of work so that I could go and play in there. You know, I mean, well, why not put out a press release, you know, ahead of my going there? Tell people what's going to happen, and it's, you know, it's terrible.
Yeah.
But this was an unproductive plant, and we had to. But you know, maybe something little good can come out of it, because we are going to invite an artist to make some use of what's there before it finally all gets demolished.
Of the material and of the place, and of the people's expertise.
Yeah. No, they wouldn't do that.
I mean, I think that what you're talking about with this this apprenticeship is actually kind of interesting also that when you went to the workers, they were very generous, I think, with what they were able to give you, right? And what you wanted, but then when you were talking to people who were not working as much, you got more pushback. Right?
Well, I think it was senior management who were, you know, who were concerned with the industry's, with the corporation's image, and were very careful about trying to eliminate the possibility of bad publicity. Whereas the people on the ground were in this case and in other cases much less kind of concerned with that. You know.
Now, so in our process now, in our public art commissioning process in the city of Philadelphia, we do a lot of sort of community engagement. And then we have a lot of, that's like a big part of how a project gets developed so that it's not, so that it's reflective of an artist's practice, but not also just we're just forcing something onto a certain community. Was there any kind of?
No, there wasn't. There wasn't. And that's interesting that you would say that, because when we talked about returning the sculpture, mm-hmm. I have made it clear that I would like to do it in the way that it was done initially. That is, there would be no advance notice of its arrival. I'm told that, yeah, maybe we can do that, but ordinarily that would not happen now.
So how would they do it now?
Well, there would be some kind of, preparation of you know, the anticipated audience for this thing. Some advance notice and possibly some meeting and some discussion. I'm not really sure what they do since the object is already formed. But I mean, I think this whole notion of arriving at a work of art through a process of negotiation is problematic, shall we say.
How do you think about that? Because I think of two of the most iconic public art pieces here in Philadelphia. I think of the Love Sculpture, Robert Indiana, at JFK Plaza, which is not even called Love Park. It's technically, it's just called JFK Plaza, but people call it a park because they love that piece of artwork so much. That is kind of like an amazing phenomenon in itself. And then the other one is Klaus Holnbrook's Clothespin. I think of those two as very iconic and recognizable, and those are doing, they engage the public in a way that you're talking about. You know, they are sort of, they exist, people happen upon them, and it sort of changes their perspective of how they understand the space and the objects that they represent. So how do you think about, because you did talk a little bit about memorial, right? In terms of like there being a bad mining accident, this being in memorial to that. And then in the book, the Cardiff Tapes, you also kind of talk about how you didn't want to tell people explicitly that's what it was. So there's a certain level of difficulty, I want to say, which is, I think, important to understanding and appreciating work in general. But is that, how do you think about that?
Did you understand the question?
Yeah, I think you could talk about the importance of difficulty in sculpture.
I'm not sure what it is I'm answering. I would like the sculpture to have some effect on the viewer. Mm-hmm. You know, the viewer would in some way carry away from it the encounter, a slightly shifted sense of themselves.
So you have a very specific way that you think that viewers should approach it or happen upon it.
Well, I mean, that's a very big question. I mean, in this case, I did because of where the site I chose, where people would have no option but to kind of come upon it in the course of their everyday business. And I didn't you know, I deliberately didn't choose a site that was sort of, I mean, the other sculptor in Cardiff chose a site that was just on the grounds of the Cardiff Castle. It was clearly a place of some, you know, importance. And the site I chose was, you know, very, very unpretentious and, you know, right there where people could not avoid it. I mean, one of the people speaking about it complains that it's, you know, well, several of them complain, but one of them complains bitterly that it's in the way and that it's obscuring the view of his business down the road there. You know, people can't see.
And that the people coming out of the bar are going to run into it.
Yeah. I mean, so I mean, in this case, yeah, I wanted it to be some kind of confrontation. You know, I wanted it to be, you know, immediate and direct, and that its presence wouldn't be signaled by its location. But I mean, that's specific. This, it's not a generalization. I mean, I think, you know, if you go into an art gallery, this is what you expect to find art. But if you're working in a public realm, it's a very different matter, and where it is and what it is are issues. I think, as I said, talking before, that I think, you know, it's important to make a distinction between public sculpture and sculpture in public places. And public sculpture is, I think, you know, is, in my mind at least, is something that there is some how or other an understanding that it's something the public wants, needs, will welcome. And it sounds as though, you know, the percent art program you're involved with tries to make sure
it's public sculpture,
that the public will welcome whatever it is they get.
You thought of this as public sculpture or art in the public when you were conceiving it, and then how?
I hadn't made that distinction at the time.
Okay.
I think the whole project really put sculpture in public places. The whole Peter Stuyvesant City Sculpture Project. But it was, you know, it was very ambiguous there, I think, you know. I the whole business is fraught, I think, you know.
Coming out of the working at British Steel and the Eva Vale sculpture not working out, and then the sculpture in Cardiff, you know, we saw the work breakdown that you made immediately after that. What has been your relationship with socially engaged work in public sculpture since that time, since the early 70s?
Zero.
And can you say more about why?
Yeah, I can. I didn't like it. The outcome of my fellowship and this Cardiff project and the other Eva Vale project was for me to make a determination. I did not want to become a corporation. I did not want to employ people. I did not want to have to negotiate what I was doing. I wanted to have a studio that would, in a sense, be a sanctuary in which, you know, I could do what I could do with my hands, and let the chips fall where they may, you know.
And how did that stand with your previous thoughts of reinforcing the status quo of the economy and culture? You know?
Well, it was okay, because for a while I stopped selling work. You know, they would make these big carpet pieces that nobody could buy.
Art that nobody can buy.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. I mean, they were pretty unsaleable things. And I mean, I think to some extent, almost willfully so. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's changed since. But yeah.
No, I mean, I still think it's an issue, it's a problem, but I mean, I do think that, you know, since then there's been this huge kind of, well, there's been a huge growth in the art market, but there's also been a tremendous kind of development of what comes under the heading of socially engaged practice in various forms. And, and it's now taught in schools, okay, right? And I don't really know what it is. And I don't know how you can become an artist who's socially engaged until you've got a practice. Mm-hmm. So how you get a practice,
sure.
You know, developing a practice in a public context seems to me to be something I can't quite figure out how you would go about doing that.
Something I think about too in terms of like learning how to give without knowing what you are yourself.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So, but in this way, you kind of are engaging in it a little bit, though, because you want to bring the artwork back, mm-hmm. right? The artwork almost becomes less about the piece and more about the story of how it has affected your practice. You know, it's really a prompt, I think.
Yeah, taking. I don't know what I'm doing if I, you know, when I take, borrow the sculpture, restore it, take it back to Cardiff. What is that? Is that socially engaged practice, or is that? I don't know what it is. You know, it's not public sculpture. I don't know what it is. I formed this idea, you know, and it was just pure kind of daydream fantasy. Like, well, what would happen now if I took the sculpture back where it was? And, you know, and I happened to mention this fantasy to some people and said, what a great idea.
They're going to do it.
Let's try and do it.
And how long will it be back there for?
Well, it's all in the works. I mean, I think we're talking of putting it back in place for 3 months or something, and then we've got to find a new home for it, probably, because funding issues. This whole socially engaged practice thing is driven by funding issues. I think, you know, you've got to, don't get me started.
Let's get started.
No, I mean, I think I think one of the things that is happening is that where public money or corporate money is involved, you know, there is some kind of requirement to make sure that things are being done that aren't too risky, that they're being done responsibly. I think that this is somewhat antithetical to the kind of risk-taking that a creative artist needs to be able to do.
I think Danny want to do some questions.
Uh-oh.
Let's see if there's anything from the audience.
Yes. Hello, hello, hello. So I wanted to pass the mic for a little while. We have like about 20 minutes left, and just wanted to also encourage folks, you know, to offer up questions for Garth about the history of this work as well as his practice today, and then also for Julia, who put out the book that documents this reflective process and also the audio recordings that Garth made, and then Jacque as well, who facilitates this kind of work today through the city of Philadelphia. So while you think of your questions, I want to ask one more question just to kick it off to Julia, which is, can you talk a little bit about the kind of questions that you sort of found in this project that made you want to do a book about it in the first place? Like, why did it seem like a good book to put out today?
First of all, the documentation. I mean, documentation appeals to me in different ways of, like I said, like a sculpture being represented through language. That's very interesting to me. And different narratives that have
fallen out of history. A different way of, I mean, I wouldn't have known about this work, but this was a different way of understanding it. But for me, it was also a lot about thinking about the social responsibilities of being an artist and what that meant. And it's something that, you know, I thought about through the process of doing the book, and I'm still thinking about. But what that means when you're a studio artist, and yeah, how do you fulfill the need to interact with and to do something for society?
I mean, you felt the responsibility to tell this story?
No, it was more in relation to my own sculptural practice of being in the studio, and one, it being really lonely, and two, feeling like I should I be doing something else? I mean, and my question about that did not come out of too much of sales.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, it's something definitely that I think about. What other questions? There was a six-part series in Studio International, a magazine in the UK that doesn't run anymore, that the series was all about sculpture.
Public sculpture.
Public sculpture. And one of the issues was devoted to the Peter Stuyvesant public sculpture, sort of city sculpture project. And the editor talked about sculpture as a privileged medium to affect social change. And so that was also something that I was thinking about through this project, about whether that is indeed true and does it need to be public if it is to affect social change.
Yeah, that was an exhibition organized by art historian called Joe Melvin at Raven Row in London a couple of years ago.
Installation where there were many pieces spread in the gallery. I'm sorry, I don't remember.
Hayward Gallery.
So I'm interested in comparing those two pieces and what your process or intent was in each of the pieces and what that meant to you and what you were expecting or anticipating from the viewers. Or if you have any expectations. And I think right away we have to define who the viewers were. So I think maybe a gallery going public may be different. So.
Well, the installation at the Hayward came about when the artist placement group was contrived to take over the Hayward Gallery, which is a large gallery. Run by the Arts Council of Great Britain in London, part of the South Bank complex. This was in 1971, and I made a number of proposals for my contribution, one of which was to the corporation that they should ship to the Hayward Gallery a sample of everything they produced, which they did fairly conscientiously. And that was its initial installation. I, during the course of the exhibition, invited other sculptors to spend time rearranging the material in the gallery. And that happened on a few occasions. I also piped into the gallery, or actually wanted to pipe in live sound from a steel mill.
but that didn't happen. So we had recorded sound. We had 16 hours of recorded sound from a steel mill in four speakers in the gallery. What I wanted there was to just create a sense of the environment where the steel was made, a hint, you know. One of the things that contributed to my crisis was actually visiting steelworks and seeing this incredible magic, you know, this dig this stuff out of the ground and light a fire under it and turn it into this stuff, build buildings and bridges. And that seemed to me to be, you know, and then you see this stuff, which I go back to my studio and I can't lift a piece this big, you know, but you see it floating around like paper and being turned from great ingots into thin sheets. And it, you know, I mean, all of this, what happens on an industrial scale compared to what I could do single-handedly in my studio with this stuff, made me feel so impotent and stupid. This has contributed to my crisis. There were other things contributing to it as well. But yeah, I mean, so that installation was something about where I was at the moment, in the sense of just saying, you know, I'm in the midst of this fellowship. This is what I'm dealing with, you know. To that installation, the installation actually got a fairly good response. The exhibition as a whole did not. The artist placement group was not, in that context, you know, very well received by the critics and the public. But my contribution to it was sort of okay.
All right, we have another question back here.
Hi. I'm interested in the images that flip through where there was graffiti and the sort of racist, you know, Asians out, National Front, sort of whites only kind of graffiti process. I mean, graffiti that happened on sculpture. And so I guess I was just curious to hear more about that and in relationship maybe to what Julia was talking about in terms of social responsibility, like how did you grapple with that at the time and perhaps what were some public conversations that came out of that? And also I just was interested in thinking about how you brought up this distinction that perhaps is very separate from this about a sculpture or an object and thinking about like in your own process, if you're like, as an object, does it invite a certain kind of interaction versus a sculpture? So in no way making a correlation that this invited that kind of activity, but thinking about like, oh, what is it about putting this object in public space that people sort of don't know how to interact with, and then this kind of reaction comes out of that? Like, was there any sort of thinking through of that happened at the time? So I guess first question would be about sort of thinking about social responsibility and graffiti, and then more maybe some distinctions around sculptures and objects.
Yeah, I think the question, I mean, there is lurking in all of this a question about, you know, the responsibility one has as an artist, and I don't want to speak to that because I do think that if you're an artist, you've got to, it's part of your practice to figure that out. But the graffiti is interesting in a way, because I think that listening to the tape over and over as I have, there is lurking in there a sense that this object is received by many people as a representative of an oppressive authority. And so in some ways the graffiti kind of reinforces that interpretation. That particular graffiti reinforces that particular interpretation. As I said, I mean, I, you know, I, I, I had anticipated that it would get. I really thought people would stick posters on it, you know, which did happen, but didn't happen all that much. Does that answer your question? Yeah, good. Did you have a question about graffiti on public work?
I did, actually. How did you know?
I would think it's a concern if you're in the business.
Yeah. Well, I mean, for that one, I mean, in particular, I think that your sculpture kind of became a platform for some kind of civic dialogue or civic discontent, perhaps. And I was wondering about how you, I'm assuming you didn't like it on there, but how did that affect your perception of the work and how public art functions?
Well, if my work was going to be a platform for that kind of display of bigotry, I wasn't happy about that.
Is that something I guess that led to not engaging with the public anymore?
Well, I mean, I don't think I don't engage with the public. I don't engage in that kind of way directly. You know, and I guess it's a different public. I mean, I guess that the public I engage with is a public that is in some way choosing to come, as it were, to my studio.
The second part of that question about the sculpture relationship between a sculpture and an object, I'd love to hear you talk about.
Well, I mean, I think at the time, we're talking early 70s, late 60s, that was a moment, maybe a little earlier, I think, Richard Long's first walk in the grass, and the photograph of the track made is 65. And then Gilbert and George a little later with their song and dance. I mean, it was a moment when people who were coming out of art schools, and mainly sculptors, were doing a variety of things and calling it sculpture that were not objects. It was not a physical thing often. It was a documentation of some activity or an activity itself, or you know, a range of things being done under the umbrella of sculpture. And I think I was interested, and I did partake in some performances, and you know, and as I said, took a lot of photographs. I was playing around with, but I think I came back to the idea that I wanted to be a sculptor, and that I was going to stick to some idea of sculpture as a language of objects. I mean, you know, just for my own practice. It's gone on from that now to this socially engaged, you know, I mean, what do you think?
Gotcha.
I think it's rich and fascinating and wonderfully problematic. But I think you have to in some ways kind of pick your battles, you know.
One thing that I would say sort of in relation to this in your question, Abby, is that I think it's wonderful when art functions at its best, I think, when it surprises us and it doesn't really know
when
it surprises us and we don't really know as audience or as makers what happens or how that happens. And then your work, I feel like, with the Cardiff pieces, even for all the things that people did not understand about it and how they used it as a platform for bigotry, then it still gave them something new. It surprised them, and it made people sort of stop and rethink something in a certain way. And there's...
Yeah, that was very much part of what I wanted. Yeah. I mean, as I wrote in my introduction or in the afterword to the transcription in the book, I think I quote, and we don't really know who it was, but it's attributed to Oscar Wilde, who said after the performance of one of his plays, he said, I think the quote is that the play was a success, the audience a failure. it's attributed to Oscar Wilde. I don't think it was Oscar Wilde. There's some doubt. Anyway, it should have been Oscar Wilde. But I think the other thing is you can't be surprised again and again and again by the same thing.
Right.
There is some thought now that the problem with this project, the Peter Stuyvesant City Sculpture Project, is the 6 months. That if the objects had been allowed to be in place for much longer, that by the time they came to be taken away, the local populace might have said, no, we don't want it taken away.
Right.
You know, we've gotten used to it. We kind of like it.
It lives there.
But that's another story, isn't it? I mean, people don't like change. Well, who does? Unless you're...
I just like change.
Well, but they're in the business of making...
Disrupting.
Yeah. I don't think people like change if it's imposed on them.
Are there other questions out in the audience?
Hmm.
One here. Any more in the back? Just like the kids.
When I started questions, just the idea of, I really enjoyed your early photographs that you said now they're in the collection. Is there any chance that you would be publishing those?
No. No, the corporation, in association with the APG show at the Hayward Gallery, did publish a small, slim volume with a selection that I had made of, I think, 39 photographs. That little, slim volume is now very rare and getting to be a collector's item. I think I have a few copies. But the photographs came to light. I mean, I took them, I made the prints, I made some of the prints. I don't know how many I made and how many another person made for me. And as I say, we published a small selection of them in 71. And then they kind of disappeared, but they came to light much more recently. And then there was real interest in them, and I got them together and sorted them and made a selection, as I said, of 164. I think there were maybe 250 some prints and a lot of contact sheets and goodness, a lot of negatives. The whole lot is now with the Henry Moore Institute, but the 164 is what I've called the work. And they did show them, and I must say, I was really impressed. I was a little apprehensive that they might seem repetitive, but they didn't at all. They seemed to build in some way. And to have a very real dialogue with sculpture, and, you know, with what's possible. Yeah, thank you.
I'm just curious whether the BBC ever did an outside broadcast or anything like that when work was installed.
The Cardiff piece?
Yeah.
There was some coverage on the radio and on the local television, but nothing significant. And I don't think the BBC covered the Peter Stuyvesant City Sculpture Project in any way, as far as I'm aware. I think there may have been local coverage in the various cities or, you know, something, you know, and a little stuff in the paper and that kind of thing. But I think it was one of the, as I said earlier, when we were talking before this event, I think it was one of the oversights of the project that there wasn't any, you know, attempt to kind of take account after the 6 months and get together with you know, various stakeholders and consider what the outcome had been. That is, as I say, it's being revisited now, and you know, yeah, yes.
And there was a question, just to plug it real quick, if the books are going to be for sale after this event, and they are.
mine is not a question either, but I just have to say that my students, right?
I can hear you.
You were saying earlier that you, one of your goals was just to generate someone to ask me a question, and I think making someone ask a question, and I think you really succeeded at that, because people were mystified. And it may be a difference in the time of now compared to the time of when that piece was first put into the public, or it may be a regional difference in the way that we say things. But I loved hearing the people comment. I mean, I could listen to that for hours. And because I imagine those people, who they are in my mind, you know, the little boy. And what I loved was so many people saying, I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is. They were saying, I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is. Which I think people would be more likely to say now if they were discomforted, made uncomfortable by it. But they seem to be mystified, and they seem to sound kind of joyful that they didn't know what it was. So I think in that way, you really achieved something with generating questions.
Well, that's a very positive take, and thank you. I
some of that was clips that were chosen. There were some angry people.
There were, yeah, I mean, I think Julia and I have a slightly different take on the tape and the transcript. I feel people are mystified, but they don't welcome this mystification. You know, they're not happy to be confronted with something that they don't know what to make of it, you know. And I mean, I think what was disappointing for me was that, I mean, that was okay. I mean, that was welcome, that sense of, I don't know what the hell this is. But then there was no willingness to engage it and speculate and think, well, what could it be? Maybe it's, you know, I mean, I think it looks like, you know, I mean, there wasn't any real kind of engagement with the thing, you know, any dialogue with it, any, you know, it was, my sense is it was, I don't know what this is, you know.
But there was some.
Yeah.
I think you hear the...
The kids loved it. I mean, the kids didn't have a problem. They didn't know what it was, and they didn't care what it was. They could climb on it, it was something new, it was, you know, and that, I think that's so telling, you know. That attitude that we lose as we gain some kind of maturity.
But the woman that came there just to see it, she was more like the kids, I think.
Maybe.
How did you see the reaction? Julia,
well, there were definitely some people that were angry, and people were angry about the ratepayers' money going towards this. I mean, there's a lot of that. But there's also this great passage where these two women are talking about, and I'm not going to imitate her voice, but it's such a melodious British Welsh voice, about how it looks like a part of the Queen Victoria. And boat and then there's a nice passage where there's a couple that's kind of going back and forth together about what it is. But yeah, I mean, I just think I pick up, I'm definitely not as close to it as you are, but I pick up on the more optimistic parts.
Yeah, there's one guy who really seems to be not troubled by it, and who seems to welcome it, and who seems to think it's worthwhile.
The scrap dealer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's a bum, really. I mean, he had no investment in, you know, I mean, he was, you know, he was... drunk bum. But he was like the kids. He thought it was. And then there's a, right at the end when I decide enough, there's a couple of men who are having a kind of conversation, and the one of them ends saying sort of, well, you know, it's making me think, and I welcome that, and maybe I'll think about it. Maybe it'll dawn on me one day what it is, but then maybe I'll think differently, and the other guy says, well, okay, so where do I go from here? And that's the end. This is the dramatic conclusion.
Can I just quickly ask? Thank you. 40 odd years later, going back into a very changed country, which has a very different relationship to art, where art is now understood and recognized, what do you anticipate the reactions to be as you kind of, I use the term restage a performative act? I think that's what now we would understand what you did in 1973 as being a temporary sculpture in a public space, which you then chose to record. It was very interesting in terms of the Hayward piece that you invited people to similarly respond and change things, which obviously comes through that St. Martin's kind of what is sculpture any longer kind of way of thinking. So kind of, as I said, 40 plus years later, going back to Cardiff, which perhaps isn't the most progressive of contemporary art arenas, what do you anticipate?
I'm hoping for a very sophisticated critique of my work. I don't know what to anticipate, you know. I mean, I think that's the point of doing it, is that everything has changed. Cardiff has changed, the population has changed. As I was noting, some students at St. Martin's have done some research in relation to this, and one of the things they did was to try to locate a city somewhere that had a similar industrial base, a similar demographic to what Cardiff had in 72, and they came up with somewhere in China.
But you did say that you don't want to have any didactics go with it or any kind of introductions to it. So you are trying to agitate a little bit.
Well, I want to do it insofar as it's possible, you know, in the way that it was done in 72, without having a preparation. But we will, when we do it, we will have, you know, some events to raise the issue of public sculpture and socially engaged practice and.
Well, in that way, it becomes more of, I think, a cultural signifier than it does actually of an object, which is delving into the social.
But it is an object, and it's a sculpture, and totally. I mean, one can talk about the uses it's being put to. Mm-hmm. But what interests me is that this damn thing is the same thing it was in 72, you know, and everything else is different.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I think that's, you know, an unusual opportunity to kind of...
Very interesting.
Do you now have the studio practice of making them?
I do. I have a beautiful studio.
And we've got our final question back here, and then we'll have some time to sell some books and hang out.
Hi. So, Garth, you mentioned that you think one of the issues with public art or art in public is that it tends to be averse to risk-taking or perhaps sanitized in some way. So I'm wondering, actually, Jacque, if you find that a challenge to public art in Philadelphia, and if there are other challenges that public art in Philadelphia faces right now.
Many challenges. I think that in Philadelphia, each city is specific and its nuances, I want to say. I think that with this one in particular, it's very interesting because, like I said at the beginning, it's such a confluence of events that have to make things happen. When the city of Philadelphia commissioned a new thing, which is where I work, the city has to spend over $1 million on a capital project. And so it has to be a very specific kind of project that happens. It has to be a very specific dollar amount. Sometimes projects nowadays happen with, it's like part nonprofit, part city. And then so if the city dollars exceed $1 million, but the whole project is $40 million, but the city puts in 10, the city only spends $100,000 on the artwork. So it's not really reflective of the entire thing. Right? And so there's a lot of things, and a lot of the things that also have to do with, I think, things that Garth are talking about that have to do with how the audience and the public reacts to things. We don't really know that. And as much as we can do community engagement, not everybody's ever going to really agree on everything. So there's really not going to be a perfect thing. And in my mind, at least, the perfect thing is just the thing that's really, that agitates, that investigates, that really pushes viewers to do something.
I want to ask you to help me thank these speakers. So let's give them a round of applause. So again, if you want to follow up with Julia, you can check out Soberscope Press. And if you want to check out Garth Evans, he's got a website with an incredible archive of his projects. And check out what Jacque is doing. He's got an exhibit up right now at University City Arts League and working on these projects for the city. So hang out, buy a book, and again, see me if you want to talk about grad studies at more. Thanks for coming.